Hello, everyone. Belated Happy New Year and welcome to our first Nature at Noon presentation for spring 2021. Nature at Noon is a collaboration between the Biomimicry Center and the Library at Arizona State University. This series explores the potential of nature to inspire sustainable innovation. I'm Heidi Fisher, Assistant Director of the Biomimicry Center. I'm joined by my collaborator, Deborah Riley Huff, Associate Director of the ASU Library, who will be overseeing the Q&A at the end of the presentation. If you have questions for today's speaker, please send them to Deborah via chat. Before I introduce Michele Lanan, I want to give you a quick heads up about the next presentation in our Nature at Noon series. At noon on Wednesday, February 24th, Michael Kozicki, award-winning engineering faculty at ASU, will be joining us for his presentation, Thinking Like a Tree, Dendrites and One Man's Search for Universality in Nature and Engineering. For more than a quarter century, Dr. Kozicki has studied dendrites, one of the most common and magical phenomena in nature. He'll be talking about his passion for all things dendritic and how he has explored branching patterns in engineering applications. You can find more information on our website at biomimicry.asu.edu. And now to today's presentation. Visualization technologies are taking us ever deeper into the microscopic reaches of our world, allowing us to glimpse even its tiniest features in stunning detail. Some of the most startling revelations have come from an unexpected source, the interior recesses of ants. These tiny insects have evolved a fantastic variety of functional gut structures. Could these remarkably diverse forms provide us with inspiration for new materials, architectural designs, or miniature medical technologies? Social insect researcher Michele Lanan thinks so. Dr. Lanan is the resident research scientist at the Museum of Natural History Southwestern Research Station in Portal, Arizona. Lanan completed her doctoral and postdoctoral work at the University of Minnesota, Tucson, where she studied the collective behavior, diet, and the evolution of gut morphology in ants. We're thrilled to welcome her to Nature at Noon to talk about small is beautiful, but could it be useful too? Welcome, Michele.
Thank you. Okay. All right. So today I'm going to be talking about some tiny structures inside of ants. And you might think that the insides of insects are all squishy goo, but I'm actually talking about the insect exoskeleton. So that means that I'm going to start here with just a short overview of the exoskeleton, because that's the material that we're going to be working with. And I'm hardly the only researcher who finds inspiration from looking at the exoskeleton. Now, exoskeleton, unlike our own endoskeleton, it works in basically the same way. You've got stiff portions of the body that muscles attach to and joints that can move. But in the case of insects, the stiff part is on the outside rather than our bones, which are on the inside. So here is just a little diagram of a joint in an insect leg, and you can see the muscles are attached to the interior of these tubes of exoskeleton. Now, the exoskeleton covers the entirety of the insect. It's not like there are gaps between the segments, because then the insect would dry out and die. The difference in these joints between the stiff segments and the bendable joint is in the quality of the exoskeleton. So here I've highlighted the stiff areas in blue, and then the membranes between those segments in pink. And it's still made of exoskeleton, but the pink part is flexible, so it can bend in a certain way. Insects also have an endoskeleton, just like we have an endoskeleton. The attachment points for muscles, especially big, strong muscles, are these ligaments that are essentially invaginations of the exoskeleton, or like processes that go inside the body for more muscle attachment. But the muscles are not the only thing that interacts with the exoskeleton. For instance, in insects and other arthropods, the entire respiratory system is made from the exoskeleton. So at the spiracles, which are those round dots you see on the sides of caterpillars, the cuticle is an invagination. It goes inside the body, and then it branches and branches and branches in a dendritic structure. Shout out to the next talk. Beautiful dendritic structure. And those tubes become smaller and smaller and smaller, and eventually deliver oxygen to all of the tissues, all of the cells in the entire body. So this system is one of the limitations on the maximum size that insects can achieve, because oxygen can only diffuse so far. So you can't have a body size, for instance, the size of me, and rely on this kind of a respiratory system, but it's very efficient for the insects. So how is this integumentary system formed? And I'm going to start calling it the integument or the cuticle now, because that includes the tissues that build the exoskeleton. Here's a caterpillar. I chose this because it's pretty simple body layout. It's got segments. And here I've kind of outlined in blue where the integumentary system is. So obviously it covers the exterior of the animal, but it invaginates in through the mouth, and it lines the interior of the front of the digestive tract, and it comes in the rectum and lines the hind portion. And it goes in through every spiracle and lines all of the trachea. So when this animal molts, it actually has to tear those internal structures out as well. And you can see this if you find like a cicada molt shell, there'll be this fluffy, lacy, it almost looks like spider webby material attached to that molt shell. Those are the trachea that have been pulled out of its body. So how does this wonderful structure grow? Here is just a diagram of a cross section of the integument. The upper layers near the exterior of the animal, or the interior of the gut, are lined with stiff, hard cuticle, and it can be different thicknesses. So I've highlighted that in blue. Lower down, you have flexible, soft cuticle layer. And then at the bottom, you have the basal membrane that separates the cells, a single layer of cells that secrete this layer of cuticle from the body tissues. And then on the outer surface of the animal, you often have secreted structures and molecules such as waxes, scales, hairs that help protect the exterior of the animal or for some function in the environment. So what is this material sheet made of? The basic component is chitin. And like other biopolymers in nature, so everything from lignin, cellulose, our own keratin, the basic backbone is a bunch of small molecules linked together. In this case, it's a sugar. Just like in cellulose, which is a string of sugars. But chitin differs in where the sugars are hooked together and in the fact that each sugar has an amino group attached to it. So there's one nitrogen per sugar. So it's still a pretty low nitrogen material, but it's not as low nitrogen as, say, cellulose. So the organism is making these long strings of molecules, chitin. They're secreted and put together by this basal layer of cells. And if you don't modify it any further than that, what you get is a fairly transparent very pliable and strong material. And you can think about this as like the outer coating of a caterpillar. So I have a picture of a caterpillar's prolegs here. And if you've ever messed with a caterpillar, you'll kind of understand the physical properties of a sheet of fairly unsclerotized chitin. Insects can make this kind of pliable, strong, fairly transparent, light-colored material more elastic by adding a few other proteins to the mixture. But it's mostly layers of this chitin with these other proteins mixed in. So the lower layers of an insect exoskeleton are always made of this. However, the upper layers can become hardened. And if you think about an insect that's just molted, it'll come out really pale, and then over time it turns a darker color. That is this process called sclerotization. So that's the cross-linking of all of those chitin molecules to make them stronger. So you bind them together in more and more places to harden it. And the chemical process is actually equivalent to tanning, like tanning leather. You can even harden it with further mineralization. So there are a few cases of insects actually putting metals in the hardest parts of their body, such as their mandibles. And of course, crustaceans do this by adding lots of calcium to their exoskeleton. But you can imagine, you can look at this upper layer as being hard, stiff, and resilient. Think about a big crunchy beetle. Now, what neither layer has is springiness, right? So you can have it soft and flexible and pliable. You can have it springy. You can have it hard, but you can't have it stretchy. Chitin tends to just break when it stretches. And that is why insects molt, right? So a new caterpillar molts to the next instar. The cuticle is essentially a little bit baggy. It's a little bit folded up, which gives the animal room to grow until it needs to molt again, but it can't stretch past that point. So this is the material that we're going to be talking about today. Not stretchy, except via folding. And the ants really take advantage of the folding. One last thought here. People have tried to work with chitin in various ways, and it is a useful material. But I think in the future, especially with our increasing ability to do things like 3D print with cells or place cells on some kind of framework and then get them to either grow or produce a material, there's going to be more potential for producing chitin objects, because if you look at this diagram, right, it's a single layer of cells. So you could put a layer of excreting cells on any shape, and if you could get them to produce their chitin structure, you could potentially produce that shape. So it's just a thought to put out there. And then, of course, we can't forget the fun toppings on the outside of the insect. Here's a little insect that is covered with wax. And there's been a lot of investigation into the different types of reflective or hydrophobic or other neat properties to these surfaces. The point I want to make here is just that you can potentially have secretion of interesting molecules on the exterior surface of an insect, you could potentially have secretion of interesting molecules on the interior of the gut where there is cuticle lining the gut. Okay, so back to ants. Now that we've talked a little bit about chitin and the insect cuticle, this picture should make a little more sense. So here's an ant. She is a replete of a honeypot ant. And these ants have a special class of workers who just stay in the nest all year long. They never leave once they're an adult. And their job is to hang from the roof and ingest liquid food, sugary liquids that other ants bring in. And they swell up really big like this. So what you can see on her exterior is the brown parts of her body are the sclerotized portions of her exoskeleton. But when you get down to what we call her gaster, it's really her rear end or the back part of her abdomen. You can see the plates, the sclerotized plates of the gaster sort of floating there on a big round ball of that flexible membrane that's in between the plates. So what this ant has is a large amount of that thin flexible material between the plates all folded up. And then as she fills up her gut, it stretches out until it reaches some maximum size. And you can actually see a little bit of the stretching and folding on that surface. But I'm also interested in what's happening inside this animal, because there's got to be some way to hold and manage all of that liquid on the inside, not just the outside. Okay, so that brings us to what is inside an ant? So here's a little diagram of an ant, and I've drawn in her, the workers are always female, her digestive tract. So we break down the insect gut into three sections in all insects. The foregut goes from the mouth all the way down to the abdomen, or an ant's, the gaster, to what we call the crop, which is part of the foregut. That's that chamber there. And then it ends at the proventricular valve. And that's the valve where food moves to the midgut. The hindgut is also an invagination of the cuticle. So everything I've outlined here in blue has a cuticular lining and is attached and has the same kind of cells as the exterior. And then there's the midgut. And the midgut is made of different tissue. It's where most of the absorption of nutrients takes place in the animal, although not all. And the midgut is not lined with cuticle. So ant researchers, of course, are really obsessed with the evolution of eusociality. How is it that all of these animals can live together and reproduce together? What is happening in the world of an ant colony? One morphological feature that researchers pointed out early on in the study of ants was the division between what belongs to the collective and what belongs to the individual in the morphology of the gut. So the crop is a storage organ, and ants can fill that up with food, bring it home, hold it there for an indefinite period of time, and then regurgitate it to share with other ants. They don't necessarily ever have to digest that food themselves. They're holding it for everyone. So all of the food in all of the crops and all of the ants in a nest, that food kind of collectively belongs to the whole, and it gets shared a lot. Then there's the proventricular valve that walls off or dams off that holding tank. And then there's the midgut, and the midgut is this individual stomach. That's where she digests her own food. So once that food passes through that valve, it's really done the transition from belonging to everyone to belonging to this individual. So for that reason, for a long time, people have looked at that valve as a potential important structure for the evolution of sociality. So I've been really interested in this structure for a long time now. And one of the things about it is that it is wildly morphologically diverse. So I've just put a couple sketches here of a few varieties of this valve found in ants. But I'm going to show you a lot more in a bit. So in this talk, I'd like to discuss, first of all, how do the ants build all these wild shapes in this valve? Second, how do these valves work? And is there anything useful that we could take out of these structures? And third, what is the purpose of all the microsculpturing and folding that we see in this structure? Because some of them are just incredibly detailed and interesting. I think it's reasonable to hypothesize that when you've got this broad of a diversity of form showing up and evolving in a fairly short time frame in a clade of organisms, that this is probably a pretty important structure that's under some kind of natural selection. So here are just some a subset of the diagrams I've made for a paper describing the variety of forms that this thing comes in. So the proventricular valve in ants was first investigated by Thomas Eisner with William Brown and E.O. Wilson in the 50s as part of his doctoral thesis. So that was my starting point, because I wanted to know everything that was already known about this valve in the ants. And it turned out that almost everything was done by Eisner, and no one really followed up on it. And he used mainly light microscopy. So he did hole mounts. I actually have his original slides now. And so these pictures below are some of, are from his slides. Those are hole valves that he mounted and I photographed. And so he described how some of these things probably work and their form, but he didn't investigate the morphology uniformly across the ants. So there were an awful lot of undescribed, unknown, totally mysterious features for me to pick up and investigate. So I've been investigating ant gut morphology evolution for many years now, and I've collected ants from all around the world. And in the below, I've just put a evolutionary tree where I've highlighted genera where I've got at least one sample. So I have pretty good coverage across the ants now. So I feel like I'm finally at a point where instead of just describing how a particular structure works, I can pull out some of the big patterns in the development of this structure. So what tools do I use? I use light microscopy as well, but I've also been using a lot of scanning electron microscopy. I have done some thin sectioning with transmission electron microscopy, and I've used confocal microscopy both to look at whole structures and slicing through structures, and also to look at how objects actually move through the valve in live animals. So let me show you how I think the ants build this structure and how evolution has designed it from a simple tube. So no matter what shape we're looking at, the basic design is a tube. And I'm gonna try to orient you on my pictures. So I have turned every picture so that the mouse is up. That will hopefully help. And then if the picture is colorized, and I've colorized all of the SEMs, I have colored the crop blue. So you come down, and normally I will tear that crop open so we can see the mouth of the valve, but there will be part of it there, and it will be colored blue. Then I will orient the valve so that it is pointed downward, so food is going down, and then it will enter the midgut and go down towards the rectum. Another note on the pictures is that the in all of most of the SEMs, I have dissolved away the musculature that is attached to this armature, because I want to see that structure and how it can move and is folded, and I want to see the microstructure. But that means that we have to imagine the soft tissues. So in a few cases, I've actually drawn on where the muscles would attach. So just bear that in mind. In a live animal, there would be muscles wrapping around this thing in every case. Okay, so let's fold a tube. So crop is up, remember, so that wide plate is the bottom of the crop. Picture number one is just a funnel-shaped tube, and it goes down to the midgut and ends. Now, we can change the shape of that tube. So number two is closer to the actual organization of that shape in most of these animals. So it's usually kind of a little funnel, and then it goes to a very small tube. And then in every case, in every single ant, for whatever reason, when this enters the midgut, it folds back on itself before ending. So here's a cross section of that. So no matter what proventriculus we're looking at, it will always have this goofy little folded back end, and then the cuticle stops. And that is where it enters the midgut. So looking at this cross section of this basic design, you can imagine if the crop was full of food and we needed to stop it from going into the midgut, the way we would do that is to have a bunch of circular muscles around the thin part of the tube. And when they're active, they would squeeze it shut. So if we keep those muscles active, we keep the valve shut. Easy. But that means we're expending energy to hold it shut. So it's not a very strong design, at least for long-term use or large loads. And some ants have this basic structure. They're not any more complicated than this. So let's fold this tube down one of the avenues that evolution seems to have taken. So we'll start with that tube. And in the ants, there's always sort of this cross-shaped symmetry to the design. So on this one, we're going to pinch the entrance closed into a very tight X shape. So the third one over has this X-shaped opening that is tightly closed. And then we're going to pull that up and bulge it out like a button. Let me show you from the underside. So, and that button shape is sclerotized. So to this point, everything has been that thin, flexible material with very little sclerotization. And now we're gonna add some heft to that button. We're gonna make it strong and springy. So if we look underneath, you can see that first you pinch it in to the cross shape, and then you pop it up and bring it back around like a button. The muscles on here, there's now a bulb, and that bulb has four sort of sclerotized ridges going around it. I think that's the picture I want to show you. So now it's passively closed. You don't have to do anything to hold that X-shaped slit closed, because it just, that's the resting position of that button. But if you squeeze that bulb by contracting the muscles that go between those ridges, you can open it, but only a little bit. And we'll see later that there's actually hairs covering that surface. So it never gapes open, but it opens enough to fill the bulb with liquid. And then there's another set of muscles that can push it through. So it's passively closed, and you only have to use the muscles to activate that springy mechanism when you want to pump liquid. I'll give you one more picture. So here is a cross section of that device, and hopefully that helps a little bit. As far as I can tell from some tests, the point of having that button shape that curves back around on itself inside the crop is to add a springy ring around that cross-shaped opening to ensure that it stays closed and that it can't open very far when you squeeze it. So it maintains the filter and it keeps it from gapping. And here are just some drawings of some versions of this particular design. So that's one route. Let's look at another one. Okay, so here's another route that evolved separately that transitions from active closure to passive closure. So now we're going to make a cross-shaped narrow opening again, but we're gonna do it in the middle of the sort of bag part of the valve. And we're going to make four springy long rods protruding up into the lumen of the crop that have a beautiful coating of micro filtering, and they've got like a tube running down on the interior of them. So they're like these long springy rods that also serve as filters. And then you've got a bulb again, that seems to be independently derived, but very similar, that can pump when the muscles contract. So you've got a set of muscles that can kind of open those springy rods, and you've got a set that can contract the bulb and pump the liquid down. Here's top view of those. And oh, there's the sclerotization. And here's a cross-section of this particular one. So there are several more evolutionary trajectories in the ants for folding a valve out of a tube. But these are the two designs that have the greatest diversity of ants using them. So these are kind of the two evolutionary routes that lead to a great diversity of species using this design. And interestingly, both these groups of ants, this is the formicines and the other one was the dolichoderines, they are ecologically dominant, and they're the ants that exploit sugary liquids the most. So these designs seem to be associated with a lot of liquid feeding, which is pretty neat. So that's the kind of origami of making a valve from a tube. And now I'll show you some of the details, because they are equally beautiful.
We're about 37 minutes in, so
just seven. Okay, great. So wasps and bees also have this structure. All insects actually have ventricles. But on them, it's sort of an open gizzard-like structure. So it's got a lot of big, stiff brush or pokey hairs on the upper surface. Some of the more basal ant groups have very similar structures to the wasps and bees. So here's one that's kind of gizzard-like. Here's another. This is Anachetus, and it's a very sort of open gizzard-like grubventriculus that could kind of grind up food and would need active closure at the bottom of it. Then we have some ants, for instance, the army ants, New and Old World, that have lost a lot of the detail on this structure and have just gone to a very simple, very flexible tube. So this may be an adaptation to handling kind of chunky food, because these are predatory ants. So it may be that you can send more sizes of objects through if you just keep it really thin and flexible. Here's one of, this is Tetraponera. I'll show you Ferellius. So this is one of those button-like structures, and you can see the upper surface is covered with really dense, really fine hairs, and you can't even see that X-shaped slit if you're looking at the top of this structure in the bottom left. You can't see the opening because it's covered with hairs. And even when the bulb is pumping, you still wouldn't see the opening because it's covered with these incredibly fine hairs. So this is definitely a filter. Another interesting feature that all of the ants seem to make use of is, again, you can't stretch the cuticle, but they need to have a crop that can expand and contract. The way they do it is by folding. So if you look in the lower right, you're looking up at the bottom of the crop. So that's the bulb sticking through that's pink. And look how beautifully it's folded. So that thing can expand all the way out to being completely unfolded like a balloon and then shrink back in. And it has muscles around it that help it to do that. And there's some truly lovely folding patterns that show up in these things. I'll show you another one in a little bit. Here's another folded crop. So you can see this whole crop above proventriculus on the left. And that really highlights all of that folding. There's quite a number of these different button-like shapes. Here's the other folding trajectory. So you've got the four stiff rods covered with the fine hairs attached to the crop, which is nicely folded, and the bulb down below. And there's a bunch of versions of this one as well. And here's just a detail of one of those rods. So there's actually an interior tube in the center below the place where those hairs are touching each other. But you will never see it unless you really tear this thing apart in a dissection. It doesn't open up. So liquid food has to go through all these hairs to get to the midgut. And I actually ran some tests. This is a crazy looking picture of a confocal image and of one of these. And the little green spots are microbeads that I tried to send through one of these structures in a live ant. And they're 200 nanometers. So these are quite small, sort of bacteria, small bacteria sized. But a few of them do make it into those long tubes and end up in the lumen of that bulb. You can see a few in there. And I have reason to believe that there's actually some secretion of material by all those hairs that helps actually just channel small particles down, just like mucus production in our own respiratory system and the microvilli. Yeah, and then I will end with this craziness. So as I mentioned, there's some other really odd structures that pop up. This particular proventriculus belongs to this ant, Cephalotes. And this ant's closest relatives are all the ones with the simplest actively closed plain old funnel shaped tube design. And yet they've evolved this totally bizarre proventricular valve. It looks like this from below. A little hard to work out exactly how the liquid goes through. But the take home message is that this is an incredible filter. It doesn't open up. Here's a view looking straight down at it in the upper right. And it's covered with these tree-shaped spiky hairs. It has, again, a dendritic branching pattern of channels inside of it. It's quite beautiful. In the bottom right, I've cut it in half and flipped it over so that you can see the spiky trees on the surface of these branching tubes. And in the upper left, I just want to point out this absolutely gorgeous and completely novel folding pattern for elasticity of the crop. So instead of the zigzag folds, this ant has independently developed this hexagonal twist folding pattern for crop expansion. It's beautiful and quite elegant. So again, there's a secretion of material that you're not seeing in these cleaned up images. So these spiky trees on this particular proventriculus hold this thick layer of very uniform material. And these ants have specialized bacteria in their gut. I threw this all in here just because, but I want to just highlight how this works real quick. So in the bottom right, the yellow spikes are the surface of the cuticle on the upper surface of this particular valve. Then the red material is this uniform, sticky, very thick, very finely poured material that is probably secreted by the cells underlying the cuticle. And then on the upper surface, on the interior of the crop, those are bacteria in situ. And you can see how large they are relative to this red layer. They're being filtered out. No bacteria can make it through this ant's proventriculus to the midgut. None. So I tested the porosity of this particular valve in this ant. This slide just highlights that there's a very special microbial community in the midgut. That's that orange color. And this valve is protecting it. Yeah, here's how it works. So this is a cross section. And I tested what size of objects can't go through. I thought I took those out. Okay, here we go. So I tested microbeads in this size range, 0.2, 0.5, 2, 6, and 10 microns. And none of them went through. So this ant can filter out items at least as small as 0.2 microns, probably smaller. I just didn't have any microbeads smaller than that. And this ant's periventriculus is as good or better than this $18,000 millipore system, right? This is an incredible biological filter. And the best part is that these ants can actually, they've got a strategy for inoculating their gut with the right microbes before they put this filter in place to protect it. So they only secrete that filtering layer on those spikes about a day after they emerge from the pupa. And the very first thing they do when they come out of the pupa, there's an unsclerotized ant down in picture E and F. So she's light colored. She hasn't canned yet. And she's soliciting anal secretions from one of her sisters so that she can inoculate her gut before sealing it off with this wonderful filter. So in this case, it's an adaptation for immunity. So I guess I want to finish with here's Myrmecocystis again, this ant that has this amazing ability to hold vast quantities of liquid in her gut for long periods of time. She somehow keeps that liquid from fermenting. She has a lot of really cool microbes in her crop that are probably helping with that, and I'm working on figuring that out. And she has this extremely strong, robust, very well-developed proventricular structure that is regulating the flow of liquid out of that giant chamber. So this is one of the ants I plan to be investigating next. So with that, I'd like to thank a lot of folks who've helped me over a lot of years, and I'll take questions.
Well, that was really fascinating talk, Michele, and beautiful, just really gorgeous structures. So we do, yeah, we've got a lot of comments here. Very interesting, really fascinating. Thank you. We have one question from Kristen, who is asking, so are the different structures based on where the ants are found or where they live?
Yeah, so they're not, which is interesting. I can find all the structures in various ants right here in the Chiricahuas. The different structures are associated with different evolutionary lineages, but they can be in the same habitat. So it seems like it's more which type of structure they have seems to have to do with who they evolved from, but also probably what kinds of food they're using and also what microbes they're hosting.
So. Okay, great. Yeah, interesting. Thank you. The next one is, can you tell us how difficult is it to do this kind of a visualization work on ants? Do you need to have high functioning access to, do you need to have funding and access to high powered microscopes?
You do need to have access to high powered microscopes, but it's not as difficult or expensive as you might think it is. I've done some of the prep at home here. Actually, this year I've only been able to work from home, and I can still do. So you need a steady hand for doing good micro dissection, which I do by hand under the microscope, not with any assist, and good tools for doing that. So you do need a good scope and good tools, but that's, you know, a few hundred dollars for the tools. And then you need access to a prep lab if you're going to do any of the electron microscopy, but any big university has a prep lab that you should be able to use if you are affiliated with that university. So I would just go down to the prep lab associated with the microscopy center at the U of A. And even after I left for another job, I came back a couple of times to work with colleagues there. So I'd bring all the samples I detected and then mount critical point dry, stain them if they needed to stain there. But that's not the kind of equipment that you would want to have yourself, even in your own lab. It's better to use a shared facility, and it just takes like an afternoon usually. And then you, you know, you book time with the big microscope that really only a university or big institution affords, one of them. And, you know, you book a couple hours and you bring all your samples, and it costs, you know, $50 to $100 an hour. So you do a couple hours and you get a whole bunch of pictures.
Right, great.
And the confocal, I just borrowed one that was in a lab of a professor that I knew, and that was wonderful.
Okay.
So, yeah, it's not as bad as it seems like it might be, as long as you have access to a facility somewhere through some affiliation. And ask around, because people who do imaging are, I found that they're really happy to help you and give you all their secret recipes and help you troubleshoot problems.
Oh, fantastic. Yeah. We do have a core facilities list here at ASU that you can access it and see where you can book time.
So you just contact those folks and then, you know, ask for help if you need it. Like, oh, I want to see bacteria in situ. What should I do? And like, I would tell you, don't use glutaraldehyde, right? because people figure these things out by trial and error. It's sort of this weird art form.
Yes. So we have a question from Stefan asking, how quickly did they evolve new structures? And does that limit how quickly ants can switch their food source?
Yeah, so it looks like a couple of times they did it really fast. So like cephalotes, I think that's in the last 40 to 20 million years that they developed that thing. And you can imagine if it is just a folding type situation that it might be pretty quick to change one gene and end up with a different shape. Because I could imagine some pretty simple genetic control for shape modification there. So in some cases, pretty fast. The two major lineages that go from active to passive, interestingly, did it concurrently with the rise of the angiosperms, which is just about when extra floral nectar, floral nectar, aphid, honeydew, all of those sugary liquids suddenly became really abundant. But as far as I can tell, the timing matches up with angiosperm. So that's exciting. As to whether it limits what they can eat, I think yes. Like all of the passively closed structures are not going to allow any particulates through. So those ants are doomed to only eating liquids, period. And you say, but wait, I have seen ants catching insects. Don't they eat solids? And here's how they get around that. They feed it to the larvae. So most ants that don't have the simple tube shape can't eat solids, but their larvae can. So they bring those solids home, they give them to the larvae digest them and regurgitate a big droplet of pre-digested liquid from the solid, and then the adults eat it.
Wow.
So that's how they got around it, because the ant larvae have a wide open gut, so they can eat, you know, they can deal with any number of shapes of objects. And they also, they'll do a lot of external digestion. So they'll like hold a chunk of something and then just extrude digestive juices on it and then suck it dry. So the larvae, you have to think of the larvae as a second stomach that works completely differently for every ant colony. So even if it looks like the adults have some kind of weird evolutionary dead end that limits them only to certain kinds of liquids, they're getting around it with the larvae.
Okay, great. That answers somewhat of the next question as well. And then another question we have is, how did you decide to study ants?
How did I decide to study ants? I don't know. I'm a bit of a, my interests in science are pretty broad, and they always have been.
Mm-hmm.
And I had some difficulty in, you know, choosing a really narrow field to focus in on. And I think I really like nature and organisms in general, and the ants are just so diverse and so bizarre and so variable in their behavior. It's like, name a thing, it turns out ants did it. Agriculture, oh wait, ants, they, you know, they domesticated these mealybugs. Oh, collective behavior, they can form all these different kinds of swarms and they communicate in all these different ways. And, you know, they, compared with something like a, say a grasshopper that, you know, goes through its life cycle, it eats, it reproduces, and it has a pretty set number of behaviors. Ants are just like all over the place. So they seemed like an exciting organism for me to focus on, because you just never run out of things to learn about them.
Yeah, it sounds exciting.
Stuff.
Yeah. Kind of with our kind of collective intelligence as well.
Yeah. Yeah. And I've done some collective behavior stuff. It's really fun. And you can also keep them, right? You can keep ants and you can watch them and see what they're doing. And so it's nice as a system.
And then, yeah, that's great. That's true. Thank you. And then also, could you talk a little bit about the importance of this kind of basic research?
Well, I mean, if you don't know what you're looking at, you're not going to get anywhere, right? Like, I think often the tendency, especially in recent history, has been to sort of skip the basic natural history in favor of, you know, promoting the really showy, exciting, experimental studies. But if you're missing some bit of basic natural history, you can design a study that is utterly useless. So for instance, if I told you that, you know, adult ants have this structure that limits them to only eating liquids, you would say, oh gosh, I can design all sorts of questions about, you know, that why they're limited to using liquids and how that limits what they're doing in the environment and so forth. But we miss the bit about, but they have larvae that can digest solids just fine and share it with them. So if you're missing that piece, and I'm sure there's other pieces I'm missing, suddenly the study of, oh, how do the poor ants deal with only eating liquids in this environment? It's a worthless question, because they don't only use liquids in the environment, right? They're not limited by that structure. But more fundamentally, for any field, you need to know the basics and you need to do that deep dive and find out what's in there before you can make an advance to a really novel and exciting development. You know, you need to look at the ants and work out what their behavior actually is and how they actually communicate before you can build a nice model of ant collective behavior. I've seen a lot of models of collective behavior that are based on unreasonable assumptions. And so it limits the utility of that model because you miss something basic about how the ants are actually solving that problem. And it's usually something really good and useful, because nature designs great things. So I don't know if that answers the question.
It does. Yes. Thanks so much.
Plus it's fun.
Design beautiful things. Right. And that brings us back to the importance of biomimicry. So we are at time. We're at 1 o'clock. And so I want to thank Michele and Heidi for helping to bring this to us. And if you have any questions, you can email. The email was in the sign up, and we'll be happy to get back to you. So again, thank you.
Thanks, everyone. It's been great.